Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Blessing in Disguise by Lauraine Snelling. Narrated by Callie Beaulieu. Prologue. Oslo, Norway. July 3, 1889. Dear Mr. Moyer, thank you for the ship and railroad tickets, as well as the information on your ranch that you sent to me. I am sad to inform you that I will not be able to arrive on the date you specified. I have made arrangements to change my arrival date from September 1st to October 1st, due to some difficulties that have arisen with my family. I am sorry for the inconvenience this will cause you, but I was unaware of this situation when I corresponded with you earlier. I truly hope it will not be too much of an inconvenience, and I am sending this immediately so that you will know not to meet the train on September 1st, 1889. I look forward to our union as our contract specifies. A friend wrote this letter for me in English, like before, since I haven't been able to learn the language yet. Sincerely, I remain your future wife, Asta Borsland. Chapter 1. Blessing, North Dakota. July 3, 1889. Hoof, duh. Bridget Bjorklund sank into the rocking chair on the back porch of the Blessing boarding house and fanned herself with a folded newspaper. Her swollen feet hurt, her back ached, and the thought of rising and doing all this over again in the morning was more than she wanted to think of at the moment. "Moore, where are you?" Hjelmer called. "Out here." Her son was the last person she wanted to talk to this evening. If he saw how weary she felt, he'd tell her again to send for Augusta, her eldest daughter and his older sister. Hjelmer thought he knew all the answers, especially since he had become the area's representative to the Constitutional Congress for the soon-to-be state of North Dakota. While they hadn't been formally admitted yet, everyone knew it was just a matter of time at this point. If the representatives and other politicians could come to an agreement, that is. She plastered a smile on her face and heaved herself out of her chair. After swatting one of the mosquitoes that persistently whined in squadrons around her head, she opened the screen door just in time to almost bump into her son's broad chest. "Were you sitting down? Are you all right?" She ignored his questions and only through sheer will kept herself from limping on her way to the stove. "The coffee will be ready in a couple of minutes." She brushed a lock of snowy hair off her forehead with the back of her wrist. After all the wishing for the wind to die down last winter, now she would give an entire day's baking for a breath of breeze. "Hot, isn't it? Oh, that doesn't begin to describe it." She rattled the grate and added a few twigs and bits of kindling to the coals in the stove. "So, how was your trip?" Hjelmer shook his head. "Wrangling, that's what. Those blowhards can find more to argue about than anyone I've ever seen. Every one of them has an opinion on every little issue and thinks his is the only right one. Seems like every time there's something the railroad men don't like, the papers get lost so we can't vote on it. Between the railroad and the flour mills, the owners want to squeeze the life right out of the farmers. I never in all my life have seen such goings on." Bridget kept herself from reminding him that he had wanted to serve in the Congress. He was one of only 10 Norwegians who'd been elected to represent the counties, and the honor had been good for them all. Surely losing papers like that can't be legal. "No, of course not. But no one can prove anything." "So when will we be a state then?" "Who knows? Even though the territory is officially divided, we have issues to hammer out, and the people must vote to ratify the Constitution first, like I told you. Seems like Norway's monarchy is easier." "More. There'll be no monarchy in this country. The government is of the people, by the people, and for the people. Remember when I read you the Constitution of the United States of America?" Bridget didn't bother to tell him how little she had understood in spite of his efforts to educate the people of Blessing. He took a chair at the table. "How have things been going here?" "Busy. Rarely a night that all the beds aren't full. If I had 10 more, I could probably keep them busy, too." "You aren't thinking of adding on already?" She could tell by his tone what he thought of the idea. While the thought had crossed her mind more than once, she wasn't about to tell him that. "So how is that new girl working out?" he asked. He would zero in on her weak spot. He had always had a knack for that. "Do you want cookies with this?" She gestured to the coffee pot she'd filled with water and coffee grounds. More? You didn't answer my question. All right. She quit. Met a man here in the dining room. He asked her to marry him and go out west to Homestead, so she did. Henry helps as much as he can, but the railroad keeps him pretty busy, too. Ilsa serves and takes care of the rooms. Goody helps me cook, and Eula, Sam's wife, does the laundry and helps with the scrubbing up when she's here. Right now, she and their daughter Lily May are out setting up the cook shack. They'll go along to cook as soon as the crew leaves. We're making do until she gets back. That should be enough. But it isn't. Hjelmer tilted his chair back on two legs. Stop rocking that chair back. I have enough trouble keeping legs on the chairs. All you men think straight leg chairs are for tilting back. You want to rock? Then go sit in the rocker. She heard the chair legs make contact with the floor, but refused to turn and look at her son's face. She'd said too much. She knew that. But somehow the words flew out of her mouth before she could clamp her teeth on them. Which led to another problem. She'd had a toothache off and on for several weeks, only now it hurt all the time. She'd snapped at Ilsa today, too, and the poor girl almost broke out in tears. That wasn't fair, she knew it, but she kept from cradling her jaw only by supreme effort. I think you should write to Augusta. Bridget sighed. We've been over this before. Augusta is engaged, and unless her young man wants to come to America, she won't leave home. But you could write and ask. Yeah, that I could. So why hadn't she? She knew the reason without asking the question. Augusta had made clear her opinion about her mother's opening a boarding house instead of staying with Håkon and Ingeborg where she could be cared for. The words still irritated Bridget beyond measure. Why did they all think she was too old to run a boarding house? She'd cooked, cleaned, done the wash, baked, gardened at every house she'd ever lived in. Ingeborg's and Karin's, no less. But here, she didn't have little children underfoot. Oh, how she missed that. The coffee began to boil, and she moved it off the hottest part of the stove to let it simmer until strong enough. Going to the cupboard, she took out the cookie jar and, setting it on the counter, arranged sour cream cookies on a plate. The jar was nearly empty. Once she'd taken to bagging cookies, the men bought the bags as they left and ate them throughout the afternoon. She could never bake too many cookies. In fact, that's what she should be doing right now. She thought longingly of her spinning wheel and the new Singer sewing machine at Ingeborg's house. At least doing those things, she could be sitting down. Resisting the desire to knead the aching muscles in the middle of her back, she set the cup in the saucer and poured Hjelmer's coffee first, and then a cup for herself. Tipping some of the hot brew into the saucer, she blew on it and sipped from that. Hjelmer followed suit, at the same time reaching for a cookie. No one bakes sour cream cookies like you do, Moore. He closed his eyes, the better to savor the flavor. He dipped the cookie in his coffee for the next bite, then looked at his mother. So, when are you going to write to Augusta? Anyone can tell by looking at you that this venture is too much without competent help. Bridget closed her eyes and shook her head. Is tonight soon enough for you? No, it should have been done weeks ago, but now will do. He loosened his tie and propped his elbows on the oak table. Why don't you write the letter? Bridget rubbed her temples with the tips of her fingers. Isn't that something you have learned to do up here with all those... She shook her head and got up to find writing paper. She kept a packet somewhere for her guests when they wanted to write a letter home. Sitting down again at the table, she dipped her pen in the ink and wrote swiftly in Norwegian, since Augusta had either refused or not taken time to learn English. She'd find out what a mistake that was, if she decided to come, that is. Dear Augusta, I am writing this at Hjelmer's insistence. Do not feel like you have to come if you don't want to. I know your intended has to make the decision for you both, but if you would consider coming here to Blessing to help me in the boarding house, I would be grateful. Every time I get a girl trained to help me, she meets one of my boarders, they get married, and off they go, usually westward where there is still free land. There is plenty of work here for Hjelmer, too, since I assume you will want to marry at home. You will be amazed at the flat country, as all of us have been. If you decide to come, we will send the tickets immediately. We are well, but still missing our dear Katie, who brought so much laughter to all of us. Your loving Moore. Here. Now you add to it. She slid the letter across the table and carefully handed him the pen and ink. And don't spill any of that on the tablecloth. It doesn't come out. Hjelmer folded back the tablecloth as she had, then added a few more lines, signed it, and blew on it to dry the ink before folding the paper and inserting it into the envelope. What he didn't want his mother seeing was his description of how tired she looked. If Augusta had any sense of family responsibility, she'd be on the next boat. But I didn't tell her all the news, Bridget reached for the envelope. You can write more another time. Hjelmer stuck the envelope in his pocket and pushed back his chair. I'd better be going. Told Penny I'd be here only a few minutes. Yeah, she doesn't let on, but she misses you terribly when you are gone. And she wants to have a baby badly. But she won't get one with you traipsing all over the country and never at home here to tend to business. He stood, then leaned forward to peer at her intently. What is wrong with your face? Without volition, her hand flew up to cover her jaw. Nothing. More. Yeah, so I have a toothache, she glared at him. It will go away. You want I should pull it? Hjelmer Bjorklund, you go on home to your wife. She didn't add, who wants you, but she thought it. When he went out the front door, she took her fan and returned to the rocking chair on the back porch, mosquitoes or no mosquitoes. Rocking in the dusk, she watched the evening star appear on the western horizon. The sourdough was set for pancakes in the morning. Sam's boy, Lemuel, had brought up water for the garden, and all the rooms were full. What more could she ask for? Screens on this porch, that's what. She smacked another mosquito and, wiping the blood off her arm with the corner of a bit of muslin, went back into the hot kitchen. If it didn't rain soon, the gardens would be a waste in spite of all the watering. Oof, duh. So much to think about. She fetched a whole clove from her spice shelf and pressed it on the offending tooth. Chapter 2. Valdres, Norway. July 25th, 1889. Augusta Bjorklund read the letter from her mother for about the 10th time. Even so, the plea for help hadn't modified any. But the instructions from her youngest brother made her eyebrows draw a line straight across her forehead, a trait she had inherited from their father, Gustav, dead now these 5 years. If Farr hadn't died, Moore would still be here in Norway, where she belongs, not over there. Augusta never had understood this craze to leave for America, when they had a perfectly good country here. So why did Hjelmer have to go and emigrate? And why have I heard nothing from him since he left? Not one word. She folded the thin sheet of paper and tucked it into her apron pocket. Talking to yourself, Soren, wife of Johan, the eldest Bjorklund son and thus inheritor of the family land, brought a basket of vegetables in from the garden and set it on the oak wash bench. Yes, and it's no wonder, Augusta drew the letter from her pocket and handed it to her sister-in-law. Read this and tell me what you think. Since Augusta hadn't been home for many months, she felt almost like a guest in her brother's house, even though she'd been born and raised here. She wetted her fingertips and smoothed a strand of hair the color of overwintered honey back into the netted bun at the base of her head and resettled the comb that usually held the shorter strands in place. Today, nothing felt in place. Let me wash my hands first or I'll get it all dirty. Soren held her hands in the air and turned to the wash basin, pouring water from the pitcher and scrubbing. That done, she dried them on a towel from the towel rack, another of the household furnishings Gustav had crafted through the years. The tables, chairs, trunks, and other furnishings attested to his skill with wood and lathe. While Soren read, Augusta glanced around the room. If she went to America, she would have nothing, for there was no money to ship household things. Suddenly, all the things she'd taken for granted looked achingly familiar and dear. So many years since she'd lived in this house. So many years she'd wanted a home of her own, complete with husband and children, with the good Lord willing. Instead, she took care of other people's homes and other people's children. It sounds like your Moore needs you. But what about Hjelmer? 2 years we've been engaged, 6 months since he emigrated, and not one word have I heard from him. How will he ever find me in the flatland they call Dakota? She shook her head. No, I must stay here until I hear from him. Sorin handed the letter back. I think you should talk with Johan about this. The tone of her voice snapped Augusta out of her reverie. You know something you haven't told me? You must ask Johan. Sorin turned back to the dry sink and dipped water from the bucket into her pan to begin scrubbing the vegetables. Heading out, Augusta closed the screen door without letting it bang. The spring needed fixing again. When Farr was alive, things like that had never gone without repair. He always fixed things before they broke. But then Farr had sons and daughters to help him work the land, while Johan had none. And though the parcel of land wasn't large enough to support two families, there was too much work for one man. A great-nephew helped Johan in the field sometimes, but last she heard, he'd been talking of emigrating too. She kicked a pebble ahead of her as she strolled down the road to the fields. So strange to have time of her own. She drew in a deep breath of brisk mountain air that, too, far different from the city where she'd been working. If it hadn't been for Hjelmer Willardson, she could have gone to America with the Larsgaards, the family she'd labored for these last 2 years. Hjelmer, where are you? If she'd been living at home, she'd be up in the high mountain summer pastures now with the cattle, sheep, and goats like all the other unmarried young women. They'd be caring for the stock, making cheese, and dreaming of the day a strong Viking lad would woo and win their tender hearts. But young I'm not. Not any longer. While Augusta knew she wasn't ugly, she didn't look at her long neck and straight nose as part of beauty either, nor the full lips that so often got her in trouble for saying more than she should. But she knew how to work hard. All the Bjorklund sons and daughters did. She'd been known as the bossy one, and Katja, dear Katie, as they called her in America, had had the gift of laughter. If she went to that Dakota country, she'd have to admit that Katie really did no longer live on this earth. Living on this side of the ocean, it was easier to pretend that Katie was still alive and making all the family over there laugh as she had here at home. Augusta would be 31 tomorrow, and well on her way to spinsterhood. Where in heaven's name is Hjelmer? For 2 long years he'd been stealing kisses and promising they'd be married soon. But the cat twining about her ankles said nothing more than a mew, which changed to a rumbling purr when she leaned over to scratch its back. When Augusta straightened, she heard the crinkle of paper from her pocket. Taking all her resolve in hand, she strode down the hill to where she could see her brother with the team. She should have brought a jug of cool water. Now, that he might have appreciated. She waited at the fence until he stopped the team in front of her. What is it? Have you come to help? Johan set the brake on the mower and climbed off, checking the double tree and hooks before he made his way to where she was petting the necks of the horses she used to drive before she had headed to the city for work. No, not really. I came out because I need an answer, and from the look on Soren's face, I have a feeling you know more than you are telling. Now, if that isn't clear as mud. He lifted his hat and wiped his forehead with the half-rolled-back sleeve of his loose-fitting white shirt. Did you bring water? At her headshake, he asked. Coffee, then? Again, she shook her head and handed him her letter. She pulled and fed the horses bits of clover while she waited for him to read it. So, more needs you. And you have no job right now, so this is a good time for you to go. Johan, I have not heard from Hjelmer since he emigrated 6 months ago. I promised him I'd come as soon as he sent for me. Johan looked at the ground as if memorizing every blade of grass. Soren says you know something. He shook his head. No, she didn't. Actually, she said to ask you, and that's what I'm doing. What do you know about Hjelmer that you haven't told me? Gussie, he wiped the back of his neck with a handkerchief pulled from a trouser pocket. Don't Gussie me. I haven't gone by that name for years, and you know it. Now, she crossed her arms over her chest. It must be something awful if he won't say. Maybe Hjelmer is dead, and I didn't even know it. It's only hearsay, and you know I don't listen to hearsay. Johan! All right, but don't say I didn't warn you. Sven Odegaard wrote to his moor that Hjelmer took up with a woman on the boat going over, and they were married soon as they set foot in America. I always told you he was no good. Johan kicked a rock under the mower, the clang causing the horses to flick their ears. Ah. If he had punched her in the middle, she would have felt about the same. When she could breathe, she squeaked out, Hjelmer, are you sure? Sorry, but that's what I heard. Didn't want to tell you in case it wasn't really so. Johan gathered his reins and climbed back aboard the mower. You can come down and start draping the hay over the fences any time. Augusta straightened her back, her Bjorklund blue eyes sparkling off bits of fire. She spun on her heel and stalked back up the lane to the house. Where are you going? Soren asked Augusta as she was leaving the house again after having just arrived back from the field, but this time with her hat pinned firmly in place. Down to send a telegram. I'll leave to help Moore as soon as they can get the ticket money to me. Calling Hjelmer every name she could think of and some she'd just created, she slung her reticule over her arm and stormed down the hill to the village. Thank God for the telegraph. She wouldn't have to wait for a letter to get there, and if she could keep herself angry enough, she wouldn't cry. Hjelmer Willardson, that waif-faced womanizer, wasn't worth crying over. Whatever made her think she was in love with him? Besides, she comforted herself with the thought, there are a lot more men than women in Dakota. She corrected her thought. North Dakota. Moore had said so more than once. Chapter 3. Northwest of Ipswich, South Dakota. Mid-August. Would she like the ranch well enough to stay? Thomas Elkanah Moyer, known as Kane to his friends, most of whom were Indian of the Mandan tribe, strode 20 paces east of his rambling log cabin home and turned to stare at the structure built by his father just before he had left for the war. He studied the long, low porch fronting the house, the stone steps leading to it, and the stone chimney built right up the middle of the shake roof. While his pa had decried the number of windows, his ma had insisted on having them. Right now, he was glad she had. Women seemed to like polishing windows and looking out, besides letting the sunshine in. Since he was so rarely in the house during daylight hours, it didn't much matter to him. Except now. His mail-order bride from Norway was due to arrive in 2 weeks. If she thought that he, at 35, was getting up there in years, would she like the house? One thing or another had to make her want to stay. Not that they wouldn't be married immediately. After all, a real lady didn't ride off in a buckboard with a man barely known to her without either a chaperone or the benefit of that bit of paper with the proper words said over it. Leastways, that's what he surmised from the few newspapers he bought on his thrice-yearly trips to the general store in Ipswich. Would she mind being so far from everything? Can't help that, he said softly, shaking his head. I warned her about the distances out here in that first letter. She had agreed to come. That in itself was a miracle of sorts. Unless she was plain out desperate, or had some physical deformity she hadn't told him about. Those and other thoughts had nagged at him more than once. He knew that a woman needn't be pretty to bear strong children, but how he hoped she was at least passable. He heard horses whinnying, and knew Lone Pine, his half-breed friend and foreman, was bringing in a remuda to be broken and trained so they could be sold to the settlers, who were burrowing into the land like prairie dogs. And twice a year, the army supply master came by to see what he had. He'd never had horses left over at the end of the season, or livestock either, for that matter. He should have been out on the roundup with them, but getting his house in order took preference. Morning Dove, Lone Pine's Mandan wife and their cook and housekeeper, had been helping him up until the day before, when she took a short break to have her son. It was the first baby to be born on the ranch since Kane's brother, who hadn't made it past the age of 2. Lone Pine's first wife died having his baby. Now, Morning Dove stood straight in the doorway, babe in a sling on her back, and beckoned him with one hand. What is it? He stopped his assessing and headed for the door. Flowers. That's what's needed. All women want flowers, he said as he leaped up the three steps and entered the house, relishing the drop in temperature. The thick, well-chinked log walls did much to keep out the heat of this South Dakota August. One of the hottest, far as he could remember, and driest. Okay, Dove, what is it? Where are you? Here, her voice came from the bedroom on the north side of the great fireplace. Kane followed the sound and found her stringing the ropes of the new four-poster bed he'd built from trees cut along the Little John River that bordered his nearly 1,000-acre ranch. A year-round creek ran 100 yards behind the house, providing water for both house and livestock, much of which was out on pasture now, being herded by one of his ranch hands. One of these days, he hoped to fence off the property. But so far, there'd never been the extra cash needed to buy that much barbed wire. Besides, fencing would cut off the trail the Mandan followed on their treks to hunt and return to their lodges along the James River. He'd promised himself and Morning Dove that he'd always welcome her relatives to his home. Several of the tribe had become wranglers for him, and a younger girl helped sometimes with the garden and chickens and such. I told you I'd do this. He took hold of the end of the rope and helped her snug the webbing tight so the bed would be well supported. With a corn shuck mattress covered by a goose down feather bed, he and his new wife would be very comfortable indeed. I know. He glanced up to see Morning Dove smiling at him, a knowing look in her eye. He'd always slept on a board not much softened by a pallet filled with either corn shucks or fresh hay. Now, don't you go getting any ideas. He shook his finger at her, only to get a laugh in return. Mrs. Like new bed. I surely do hope so. I hope she likes everything out here. What not to like? Her dark eyebrows rose in question. Oh, my friend, you have no idea what a world there is out there beyond our sandy hills. I don't know much about it either, but from what I read. For a man who had never attended school in his life, Kane had learned to look at the world through the eyes of the few books he inherited from his parents and others he purchased when he could. Money was dear, but his mind cried out for knowledge. Before his father went off to fight on the Yankee side of the war, his mother spent hours with him, teaching him his letters and numbers, and making sure he became proficient in their three R's. Beyond that, he'd grown up with the Bible, Shakespeare's complete works, and the Farmer's Almanac by Benjamin Franklin. He devoured newspapers whenever he could get them. But living 40 miles from the nearest town of any size made keeping current with the news next to impossible, so instead, he kept a journal, recording life around him, the vagaries of cattle and horse raising, his income and expenses, his thoughts on statehood, his desires for a family, for a wife who would love him as his mother had loved his father. The leather-bound volume stood beside the other books on the bookshelf next to the fireplace. No one else knew how to read, anyway. Morning Dove had washed the sheets he'd taken from his mother's trunk earlier, and now Kane watched as she put them on the bed, along with a quilt of the same vintage. He looked around the room one more time. He'd keep sleeping on his hard bunk until he brought her here. Thoughts of what lay ahead in this room made his throat hot and his ears burn. Oh, Lord, do let her be comely. I know that is trivial in thy sight, and I promise to be grateful for the woman you have brought all this way. He stifled the but and, after another glance around the room, went out, closing the door behind him. I'll be down in the barn, he said to Morning Dove as she headed for the kitchen. Dinner in an hour or so, she replied. All right. Lone Pine brought in more horses. With the hay cut and the grain not yet ready to harvest, this time was spent breaking and training the horses that were old enough and strong enough. Some of the better fillies he would keep for breeding, and one would be a wedding present for his new wife. He'd already been working with her. The bright sorrel filly sported a star between her eyes and a tiny diamond between her nostrils. Two white socks flashed in the sun when she trotted. Her canter could eat up the miles at a smooth gait. Morning Dove had been working with the filly, too, so she was already accustomed to a woman. She nickered when she saw him coming and came to the fence, draping her head over the top rail so he would rub her ears. Ah, little girl, we need to find you a name. But I've been thinking that maybe we should let the missus name you after she gets here. He still had a hard time referring to his future wife by her given name, After all, they hadn't even met yet. The filly rubbed her forehead on his chambray shirt, leaving both red and white hairs on the fabric. She nosed the leather vest he wore and sniffed his pockets. When he didn't respond, she sniffed the hair curling just under his ears and tipped his flat-brimmed hat back, nearly off his head. "Stop that now!" He leaned his chin on his crossed arms on the post. Where could he find a rosebush to plant by the front steps? Surely his wife would appreciate a sweet-smelling rosebush. He rubbed the filly's neck again, then turned and looked toward the sandy hills to the north. Where had he seen roses blooming that spring? The elm tree his father planted at the northwest corner of the house now shaded the porch and half the roof. Several oaks had grown from the acorns tossed out in back, and willows grew along the spring. Off to one side, the apple trees that had come across the country in his father's mule pack hung low with a heavy apple crop. The garden lay close to the creek for when they had to carry water to keep it growing, like this year. But the rose bush his mother planted by the front steps had died a couple of years after she did. Roses were tender things compared to the native flowers and trees. They took some pruning, fertilizing with manure once in a while, and watering. He remembered his mother always saved the dishwater for her rose bush. Kane rubbed a calloused hand along his jaw and, lifting his hat, brushed walnut-toned hair with a touch of gray back off his forehead and secured his hat again. "I'm going in early to get new duds, a haircut, and a real honest shave before the train pulls in. What do you think of that?" He turned and nudged the filly's nose. She blew in his face, then turned and trotted across the corral, twitching her tail and nickering to the horses in the other pen. When a rangy sorrel whinnied, she perked up and pranced some more. Kane figured right away they'd better get the knife out. The young colt giving her the eye wasn't quality enough to keep for stud, but with some added weight, he'd be plenty strong enough to pull some settler's plow. Gelding would settle him, too. Walking on around the filly's corral to the larger one where the newly rounded horses were shaking off the dust of the run, some still inspecting the 6-rail-high fencing for an escape route, Kane automatically judged the horses inside. They looked to be a good crop. Spring and summer pasture had fattened them right up after the lean winter. Lone Pine had told him they'd lost some due to the terrible blizzards. "How do the mares and foals look?" Kane asked when Lone Pine joined him at the fence. "Good. We got some without our brand, some with no brand." He pointed to a heavy dark bay that stood looking over the fence. "Like him. He's been broke. Look at the harness scars. Someone didn't take too good care of him." Kane hawked and spat, a direct comment on a man who would abuse his livestock. "Guess we'll have to keep him here till someone comes looking, but..." He shook his head. "I hate to send any animal back to be mistreated." After the fall work was finished, many of the farmers turned their horses loose to fend for themselves on the prairie. Most rounded them up again in the spring, which was not a hard job, for the released horses tended to band together instinctively. The men sorted them according to brands and took their own horses home for the spring field work. Several in this herd just hadn't been claimed. "Funny that no one's come looking for them yet." Lone Pine nodded. Lean as the tree he was named after, and as spare of words as fat, he shook out his lasso and climbed over the fence. Within minutes, the bay was roped, a loop thrown over his nose and tied snug to the fence. He pulled against the restraint when Kane approached him, his eyes rolling white. Kane stopped. The low murmur he used on spooked critters made the horse's ears twitch. When the animal snorted and dropped his head a fraction, Kane approached again and laid a hand on the animal's quivering neck. "Easy, boy. Easy now. You got nothing to fear here." As if trust were infused through the gentle hand on his neck, the animal dropped his head some more and blew out his fear in a rush. "That's the way." Kane continued stroking the summer sleek hide, closely inspecting the animal all the while. The hair had been rubbed off under the rump pad, on the neck from the collar, and along the shoulders from the harness straps. White scar lines still showed on the horse's lips from where the bit had eaten into them. Kane was sure some of the smaller scars were from the tip of a whip laid on with a heavy hand. When someone comes looking, send him to talk with me. The tone of his voice matched the smoldering fire of his eyes. They sorted out several for gelding that they'd left uncut earlier in hopes they would make good breeding stallions, because they got a better price for those. But these didn't measure up to Kane's standards. Three of the fillies they ran into another corral. They'd be trained but kept for brood mares. The remainder would be broke on both saddle and harness. Cut tonight? Lone Pine slapped his flat-brimmed hat against his thigh to get the dust off. He glanced up to see his wife waving a towel. Eat now. Good. Call the others. Morning Dove set bowls of potatoes and gravy along with platters of roast beef before the six men around the table, and within minutes the platters and the room were emptied but for Kane, Lone Pine, and Morning Dove. They lapsed back into the easy rhythm of the Mandan language as Kane asked if they knew where any rose bushes grew. You know, they have pink flowers. Smell sweet. Have lots of thorns, and you grind the rose hips in pemmican. At that, Morning Dove nodded. I show you. Lone Pine gave him a puzzled look. Why you want flowers? Kane looked from one to the other. Women like flowers by the house. Lone Pine looked at his wife. She shook her head. Must be white women. All right. So Mandan women would rather plant corn than roses. I just want to bring one here, all right? Can we eat roses? Lone Pine still looked puzzled. Kane sighed, but caught a look between husband and wife. They were teasing him. Some things are for beauty's sake alone. Beauty? Who is she? Lone Pine leaned forward, looking more puzzled than ever. His wife nudged his shoulder and scolded him for giving Kane a hard time. I'll help you dig roses, she said. No, you take care of the baby. Lone Pine can dig roses and maybe get his hands full of stickers. He shoved his chair back. We'll start on the horses tomorrow. Let's get a wagon and go find those roses. Morning Dove, you and Papoose can ride in the back. Bring a water jug and some of that cornbread. By evening, they had two rose bushes planted, even though both husband and wife kept up a banter that let Kane know they thought he was slightly crazy. Kane stood back after pouring a bucket of water around each bush. One shrub on either side of the front steps did look mighty pretty. Just remember to dump all the dishwater on them, he said to Morning Dove. That's what my mother always did. He glanced at Lone Pine still digging thorns from the palm of his hand with his teeth. Better to break horses any day. Kane tried to keep the laughter inside, but it burst forth in spite of his good intentions. Lone Pine made a rude hand motion and headed for the corrals, leaving Morning Dove and Kane laughing as he went. It's good to hear you laugh. Morning Dove patted her baby's back after having nursed him while the men planted the bushes. Kane thought about her comment later. She was right. A laughter had been lacking around the ranch for a long time. He wondered about his coming bride. Did she enjoy a chuckle, or would she be serious all the time? Would she fit in here? Oh, Lord, what have I gotten myself into? He sent his prayer heavenward. Chapter 4. Blessing. Mid-August. Why don't we ask Olaf to pull that tooth for you? Penny said, shaking her head. You look miserable. I suppose I've tried about everything. You know if Metis has anything good for the toothache. Bridget held a hot, wet cloth to her swollen face. Hot as it was outside, it seemed strange that a hot cloth would make it feel better, but she hated to waste the last remaining ice on her face. She had hoped to make ice cream Saturday for the harvesters. They planned a celebration for the beginning of wheat harvest. As usual, the wheat was ready at Bard's first. I could ask her if she's back. Where did she go? To visit some of her family. Penny studied her mother-in-law's face again. I think you better ask Olaf. Hjelmer said he'd do it. Sure, but who do most of the people around here go to with a toothache? You have any whiskey? That should help deaden the pain. I don't drink that stuff. Ugh, taste vile. No, just to rub it on the gum. Ingeborg taught me that. They use it for the babies sometimes when a tooth won't come in. She rolled her lips together and tried to look innocent. Of course, We all know that imbibing makes for no pain, too.
Yeah, and a hangover like some of those men have had.
Bridget shook her head and flinched at the movement.
Go ask Olaf. Maybe he can do it right away before I talk myself out of it.
All right. Then I need to get back to the store. Do you have any whiskey? Bridget responded with the smallest of headshakes and sat with her eyes closed. She knew if she looked as bad as she felt, she'd even scare the grandchildren away. All this bother over a toothache. Whew, duh. Olaf will bring some. As soon as Penny left, Goody arrived with Hans in tow.
Ugh, you look terrible. I brought Hans to chop wood for a while.
What with the washing, Lemuel can't seem to keep up. I told them if they chop a big stack, they can go fishing this afternoon.
Maybe we can have fresh fish for supper. Oh, that would be a good change.
Bridget spoke around the two cloves she now had clamped on her aching tooth. The gum around the offending tooth seemed to have grown twice in size overnight.
That's what I thought.
Eula has three chickens ready for the oven. We better let a couple of those hens set so we have some more fryers, unless Karin has extra. If Baptiste or Thorleif would bag a deer.
As she spoke, Goody, her stomach now extending with the babe she was carrying, bustled about the kitchen. While Ilsa had cleaned up the breakfast things, they had to get going on dinner. When Olaf knocked at the back door, Bridget waved him in.
Out here could be a mite cooler, he suggested. There's a breeze yet.
You go on and take care of that tooth, then have a bit of a lie down, Goody said. We'll manage things here. Bridget wanted to argue, but no longer had the energy. How could a bad tooth take so much out of one? She took the cup of hot water Goody handed her, along with some clean cotton for packing, and headed for the back porch.
I clean these pliers up real good. Olaf, still slender in spite of Goody's fine cooking, held the instrument in the air, as well as a bottle of brown liquid. This stuff is strong enough to clean pliers. No wonder it deadens pain.
He pulled the cork with his teeth and poured a couple of glugs in her cup.
Drink that.
Bridget shuddered as the liquor bit its way down to her belly. Tears pooled in her eyes as she sniffed, blinking and swallowing again.
Ugh.
Okay. Now, put this against that tooth and bite down for a minute or so. He handed her a folded square of cotton he'd soaked with the vile brown stuff. Bridget closed her eyes and did as he told her, leaning back in her rocker and trying to ignore the fire ignited in her mouth.
Ready?
She nodded and opened her mouth wide. Olaf applied the pliers with a twist of the wrist and a steady pull. The sound of the tooth cracking made him flinch. Sorry about that. One by one, he picked the pieces out and dropped them into the empty cup. Now, rinse your mouth out with this. He handed her a cup of cold water, and bite down on this. It will help stop the bleeding. Bridget did as he told her.
Manya tak.
She spoke without moving her jaw.
Maybe I should give up furniture making and the sack house and become a dentist.
Bridget shuddered and shook her head. The world tipped and took her stomach with it. Before she could protest, between Olaf and Goody, they half carried her into her bedroom off the kitchen and tucked her up in bed with a bit of ice and a wet cloth pressed against her face. She didn't argue.
Those clouds look like they might do more than just pass overhead.
Reverend John Solberg took off his hat and wiped his beaded forehead with the handkerchief he'd pulled from his back pocket. He swiped the thinning sandy hair back and resettled his fedora. Today, he looked more like a farmer than a pastor, wearing overalls like his neighbors and a sweat-darkened long-sleeved shirt with the arms rolled up. His forehead now had the demarcation line of one who spent hours in the sun, hat securely in place.
How do they look different than the ones we've had almost every day?
His wife, Mary Martha, tipped her sunbonnet-shaded face up to catch the breeze. Together, they watched as their niece, Manda McAllister, worked with one of the young horses she was breaking in the corral.
Maybe just wishful thinking.
We need rain so badly, and yet now would be a terrible time for a thunderstorm, what with the wheat about ready to cut. He leaned his arms on the top rail of the corral and set one foot on the bottom rail. While he didn't have any wheat planted and his acres of oats weren't ready to harvest, his parishioners all depended on the wheat harvest for most of their income. With the drought, the wheat looked to be stunted already.
beaten to the ground. It would be hard to cut. Manda snubbed the horse to the solid post in the center of the corral, and after stroking the animal's shoulder and rubbing its ears, she strode over to the fence, where she had a saddle ready. "I brought some lemonade." Mary Martha picked up the jug at her feet. "Surely you can take a break now." Manda nodded and set the saddle back on the rail. "Where's Deborah? She was here a minute ago." "Gone to pick the eggs. She'll be right back." Mary Martha poured the liquid into the four cups she'd brought along and handed them out. "Let's sit in the barn shade. Got to be cooler there." Solberg fetched a stool from the barn. "Here, sit on this. It will make getting up easier." "I'm not an invalid, you know." Mary Martha shook her head, her laugh infectious. "Just because we're having a baby." Manda sank down against the wall. "Don't hurt to be careful." She took off her well-ventilated fedora. While they'd given her a wide-brimmed straw hat for her birthday, she insisted on the ancient felt, more faded than true brown. It was the last thing she owned of her father's. "Ma!" 7-year-old Deborah came around the corner of the barn, holding the back of her hand to her mouth. "That darn old hen pecked me again." "Don't talk like that," Manda snapped her order before Mary Martha could open her mouth. "You said that darn horse. If you can, why can't I?" Manda picked at a blade of dried grass. "Just 'cause." Mary Martha exchanged a look with her husband. They both knew it was the ma, not the dern, that irritated Manda. She'd just gotten used to calling Katie ma when Katie died in childbirth, just like Manda's real mother had. And while she called Zeb McAllister pa, it hadn't kept him from disappearing after his wife's death. He'd gone back to South Dakota to see to the homestead rights of the girls, but he couldn't bear living on the ranch yet. Knowing her brother as she did, Mary Martha had a good idea he was back out in Montana, searching out that valley he'd dreamed of and filing for homestead rights. She figured any day now he'd ride in with a herd of horses ready to break, then take his girls and head west. But until he returned, she and John had moved from the parsonage soddy by the school to the McAllister farm, keeping it up and caring for the girls. "When Pa comes back..." "He ain't coming back." Manda whirled on her sister like an attacking badger. "Manda McAllister, he ith too." Deborah sometimes had a lisp since she'd lost her two front teeth. Her straw-colored pigtails slapped her chin as she shook her head. "You just, all right, girls, that's enough." While John spoke gently, there was no ignoring his command. "Father God, please see Zeb safe. Heal his grief and bring him back to these two who so dearly need to see prayers answered. To lose two mothers, one father, and now maybe another one, besides the two stillborn babies, is beyond what anyone could bear, let alone those so young. It breaks my heart, and I'm the pastor, not the parent." But John knew that if called to be, he would gladly adopt these two. Maybe that would be best if Zeb wrote and asked them to do so. He knew Mary Martha already acted more like a mother than an aunt. Zeb can't write if he's dead. The thought had plagued him more than once. A man by himself. Anything could happen. "Come on, Deborah. You said you'd ride for me today." "I will." Both girls handed back their cups and climbed the rails to drop into the corral. Heat lightning flared against the dark thunderheads. The wind picked up, bending the oat field like waves on the sea. Mary Martha and John stood and faced the west, grateful for the cooling wind. "It does smell like rain." "Lightning, too." Mary Martha looped her hand around John's elbow and leaned her cheek against his shoulder. "I better get the chickens in." "I'll go for the cows." John turned and whistled for the cow dog. "Manda, you better put that horse away in case we get lightning strikes." He watched for a moment as Manda led the now docile horse around the corral. She had such a gift with animals. It was a shame she didn't use it with humans, too. "Manda!" He raised his voice to be heard above the wind. "I will." John whistled again and waved the mottled cow dog out to round up the cows. Again, it was thanks to Manda's training that he didn't have to go out and get the creatures himself. Even though it was not yet 3 o'clock, the sky darkened so that it seemed like night. Rain came in sheets across the prairie and struck with a downpour instead of warning drops. John was the last to leap up on the porch without being soaked.
The four of them, dog at their feet, watch the ground spring out in puddles as if a heavenly bucket had just been overturned above them. Mary Martha stood near the step, her face raised to catch the drifting mist. She spun in a flash, grabbed the girl's hands, circled behind John, and together the three ran out into the deluge. Drops the size of teacups pounded them in the earth. Within a breath, they were soaked, hair stringing down their faces and into their open, laughing mouths. Manda chased Deborah through a puddle, stamping her foot so the water splashed them both. The dog yipped at their heels, jumping to catch the splash. Mary Martha raised her arms above her head and spun in a tight circle, her sodden skirt sticking to her ankles. "I know what." She pulled the pins from her hair and let the mass fall down her back. "Get the soap," she called to John, who watched them from the porch. "The soap?" John had to shout to be heard. "Yes, we can wash our hair." John brought the soap, and they took turns scrubbing one another's hair, then raising their faces to let the rain rinse them clean. Lightning flared, thunder boomed and crashed, trees bent over before the wind, and they finally sat down on the benches on the porch. Mary Martha brought out towels so they could dry their hair, and the brush and comb to fix it again. "I ain't never done nothing like that in my whole life." Manda sat shaking her head. She sniffed, and a smile lifted the corners of her mouth. "The air smells so clean again. You think heaven smells pure like this?" John cleared his throat, stunned at the question and the questioner. Manda had been insisting that God wasn't there. "'Cause if he is there, then why are such terrible things happening?" She'd said such more than once and in several ways. But this glimpse into her heart reassured him, and the smile he'd glimpsed reminded him that in spite of her grown-up ways, Manda Norton McAllister was still a little girl who needed a father. "I think it must." He moved closer to her and, with a gentle arm, pulled her to rest against his side. With the four of them crowded on one bench, they watched the storm let up and continue east, leaving the trees and roof dripping.
"Oh, looky!" Deborah pointed to the sky. "A rainbow!"
She looked up at Mary Martha. "Katie, Ma, said one time that babies in heaven get to play on the rainbow. You think that's true?" "I most surely do," Mary Martha kissed the little girl's upturned nose.
"Then our babies are up there, huh? And maybe my two Ma's are sitting visiting and watching them play."
Mary Martha laid a hand on her own belly, where a new baby grew, and hugged the little girl close to her side.
"I surely do hope so, Deborah. Such a lovely picture you've given us."
She sniffed for a second time and heard John do the same.
"I'll never look at a rainbow the same again."
"Me neither." She turned to see the love shining from her husband's eyes, and to think she'd heard that Norwegian men were cold and unfeeling. Whoever started such a rumor didn't know her husband, that was for certain sure. Well, at least it didn't hail. From the shelter of their porch, Håkon and Ingeborg, along with Lars and Karin, watched the storm make its way east. The children were all out playing in the puddles, covered with black gumbo and shrieking with laughter. Paws had a bit of brown along his back, but otherwise they now owned a black dog. You think it
damaged the... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.